What turned me into a girl? Just sitting up here. I don't know. It's just it's amazing. I don't know. I guess he gets me more excited every week just to come down and just spend some time with you guys. And what we're going to talk about this morning, it'll pertain to hopefully at least one life in here, but it definitely pertains to mine. It pertains to ours, and my wife doesn't even know what I'm talking about this morning, but it pertains to us. If you guys would, open up to Ezekiel chapter 37. Some of you Bible scholars might know what that is. Ezekiel chapter 37. I know I don't do Old Testament too much, but I really like this one. Now, this is kind of the first thing that came to mind when I came here 11 months ago now. This was as soon as I walked in the door, kind of saw everybody. This is, believe me, by no means this isn't any disrespect to anybody at all. I know, John, you're getting your fists ready over there. But when I walked in, this is what came to mind. Ezekiel chapter 37. And sometimes we have these places in our lives. We might look at our lives and we might sense that there's just nothing there. There's no life left. That we might as well just let it lay there and die. Has anybody ever been in a situation like that? Maybe it's a situation. Maybe it's just your life in general where you go, you know, there's just nothing left. It just might as well just end, or the situation, I might as well just leave it alone and try to move on from it. And I don't know if you've ever been in that situation, but I've been in that situation. And so as we read through Ezekiel 37, we're just going to do the first 10 verses. But hopefully it pertains to your life. But the biggest part of it is I'm talking about this morning as part of this church. Because we have revival coming up here in this next week. And I mean, I don't think there can be a better time for us to be having that. Just the way that everything's going. So let's just take a look here, and let's read through, and I'll stop you at certain points. We're just going to read the first three verses here. Ezekiel 37, verses 1 through 3. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley, and it was full of bones. Then he caused me to pass by them all around, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and indeed they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? So I answered, Lord God, only you know. You know, sometimes we look around in our life and God kind of lets us look into it. And he lets us think, is there anything left in this? Anything that I have done, is there any life left? You know, the situation that I'm in, is there any life left in it? And we're looking all around from every perspective. And when we came to the church here, I kind of stood up here, and I think there were 20, 22, something like that, on that Sunday morning. And mainly, a lot of them were on this side. And I'm sorry, but not many of them were under the age of 50. Am I lying? No, I'm not. Don't give me that look, Annabelle. She's 51. But that's kind of what it looked like. That, see, the bones are significant that there once was life. Okay, there once was life, but there wasn't much anymore. Okay, there was still some sort of remnants of it. There were bones there. Okay, it wasn't dust. It wasn't dust yet. But that there were still bones, but he said that they were very dry. Not that they were a little dry, but that they were very dry. You know, the marrow had already been taken out of. I mean, there wasn't anything left of these bones. And that's our life, a lot of us. Without Jesus, that's our life. It's dead. There is nothing there. Without God, our life is a bunch of bones. Worthless, really. What can you do with it? Nothing. Let's read on. Again he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. I will put sinews on you, and bring flesh upon you, the sinews being like tendons and muscles. Cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. Okay, number one here. Sometimes, you know, I get on you guys sometimes because you're not giving me a whole lot of feedback. But I think about Ezekiel. God told him to preach to these bones. It's never been that bad in here. Okay? You know, I could just imagine that, you know, that guy kind of looking at God like, what are you talking about? How am I going to preach? There's just a bunch of bones just, you know, strung out on the valley. What do you want me to tell these things? What are you going to do with these? There's no life left. You know, when I walked in here, I kind of looked around and thought, we got anything left? We got anything left? And again, I'm not saying any disrespect, but is there anything left here? I knew that there was a vision years ago. They bought this property. They built this church. There was a vision. Something was there. The bones were still around, okay, but there wasn't anything left of them. It was just bones. No meat, no nothing. Again, in your life, there's just bones. It's still there. You're still living. You're still breathing, okay? Some of us, we don't have a whole lot of life in us, though. I'm not saying life is like these kids, you know, getting up and running around. I'm saying life is in God. You know, that Holy Spirit that just, man, when it starts to stir, we just saw John. He got a little stirred up. You know, that's that life coming into him. I mean, he's acting like a teenage boy over here. It's like he's 13 again. Cheryl says, oh, Lord, please don't. Please don't. But, man, that's us. Those bones are us without God, okay? That's you guys. That was this church. Not that we didn't have God, but there wasn't anything pumping. There wasn't anything breathing in here, okay? And so when I get on you about being sitting there in the seat, don't ever bring up Ezekiel 37. Don't ever put that in my face that, well, he preached to dead, you know, nothing. Everybody play dead. I hope one day that Jesus comes when we're all together in here so that we don't ever have to deal with that kind of stuff. That's my prayer, is that we all go up to heaven together one Sunday morning. I think that would be great. If you can do that, God. Not that I mean a whole lot, but what? Call me out already. All right, let's read on. So he did what he told. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a noise, suddenly a rattling. And the bones came together, bone to bone. Indeed, as I looked, the sinews or the tendons and the flesh came upon them and the skin covered them over. But there was no breath in them. You see, in the original text, breath here is called ruach. All right, I'm not speaking in tongues or anything like that. It's called ruach. That is the breath of God. You see, the Holy Spirit is called ruach hakodesh in the original language. That means the Holy Spirit. So the ruach, the breath of God, still was not in these. But see, this is how effective words are. He prophesied. I mean, he told these things. You are going to come together. You are going to bind together. You are going to become one. And that within the church is like, when I first came, what did I start talking about? The community of us. The family of us. This is our family. Blood ties, they don't exist anymore, okay? The only blood ties we have is the blood of Jesus. That's what makes us family, okay? That's what's flowing through us. The blood of Jesus, that's what makes us family. So all of a sudden we get this rattling of bones. Words are so important into your life. You see, he's telling us in our life, you need to speak something into your life that it's going to be good, okay? Because some of us wake up and we're like, another day. Man, I can't wait till tonight. Let's just get it over and done with. What do you expect you're going to have the rest of the day? Bleh. Before waking up, we're going, you know what? This is going to be a great day. This is going to be awesome. This is going to be the best day that I've ever had in my life. I'll tell you how significant words are. My wife told me this, that there was a man, his name is Perry Stone. I don't know if anybody's ever heard of him. He's a pretty cool guy. I like listening to him. But they took two mason jars of rice. And inside of those mason jars of rice, he took a note card. And he put on one, I love you, rice. Rice, you are the best. You're awesome. Rice, you are great. And he put that note card down into that rice and he sealed it up. And then in the other one, he put, I hate you, rice. Rice, I hope you die. I hope there's no life in you. All these kind of negative words. And he put it down in there and he sealed it up. And he kept it in there for 83 days. And when he went back, the one that he had put, I love you, rice, and everything else, there wasn't anything in it. It was just rice. It was perfectly fine. But the one that he had put, I hate you, and everything else, it had grown mold. Serious. It had grown mold. And he had done this countless times. Tell me if I'm lying. He had done this countless times with his teen group, with his church, and everything else. That's how effective words are. Okay, he didn't change his pen. He didn't change the note card or anything else. But that sealed jar, just because of those words in there, mold grew on that rice. You tell me how effective words are. I mean, God, he's constantly saying, when you prophesy something, when you say something in your life, it needs to be positive. If you're only saying negative stuff in your life, then guess what? It's going to be negative. Amen. It's going to be negative. And so that's what he told Ezekiel. You need to say positive stuff into these bones. And after he started saying positive stuff, what started happening? Those are the bones. Could you imagine his thought as he's standing there and all of a sudden these things start shaking? Oh, I think I would have stopped. I'm, oh, no, I don't know about this. Sometimes I hear that in here as you guys are trying to get up. Oh, it scares me a little bit. But then the tendons come. So then we get bound together. And we've seen that within here, that all of a sudden it seems like the family starts to get together. And then the muscles form on it. We get some strength. And then the skin encompasses all of it. It's like, oh, we're finally here. We're standing. But we still need that breath to hit us. And we stood for a while. We were standing inside this church for months. We were together, man. But then all of a sudden, it hit. A couple months ago, it really hit. And we see it every Sunday. It's like he just, let me give you some more. And I hope that you guys are going, okay, please, you know, keep bringing it on. So what did Ezekiel do? What did he do? Let's read here. Indeed, as I looked, the sinews and flesh came upon them and the skin covered them over there, but there was no breath in them. Also, he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded, and breath came into them, and they lived, and stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army. You see, this just wasn't just anybody, okay? They have looked back, and they're pretty sure that this is one of Israel's armies, that these were the slain men of God, dead, and just strung out all over the place. And so God showed us his power by bringing not only the family back together, but each individual person he brought together as a whole. And then they all stood up together as a vast army. And that's the way that we are. That's why I said we need to be praying for our churches, because it's not just about us. It's not just about that church. We need to all stand up as a vast army for God. You see, within your own life, God is saying, I want to bring all these things back together. I want to bring your life back together. And it might come back together, but it's never going to be complete until you have me. Until you have me. Until you have my breath in you. And it's done by the unbeliever. That's done by salvation. You know, it says that when we receive Jesus, that we are marked, stamped by the Holy Spirit. Right in our foreheads. God goes, all right, you're one of mine. It's almost like cattle. You know, when you cattle prod. You know, he marks us. I'm glad he doesn't do that. We might start that. Come on up. Who wants to sign up? Somebody bring it out. We'll mark you. FMHC right here. You're one of ours. Hey, I'm probably done worse. But man, that's how God is. So with the unbeliever, it's done through salvation. With the believer, it's done through our growth and grace. As we continue to learn who God is, and it's almost like another breath. Oh my goodness, I can't take much more. And then the next thing we go, oh man, you just keep stretching me. You keep stretching me. You keep stretching me. You keep stretching me. And then like we just sang about, the potter's hand, take me, mold me. And then he fills me up. But why does he fill us up? To be poured out again. To be poured out again. And he says, all right, now I'm going to make something completely new. All right, let me breathe into you some more. Let me breathe some more life into you. So, I mean, we shouldn't come in here week after week after week and be the same that we were a year ago or be the same that we were 5 years ago. You see, God goes, no, throw the old stuff away. Throw your old wineskins away, all that kind of stuff, because they're not going to hold what I want to pour out on you. You see, they'll bust. So we come in here every Sunday. We got to be brand new wineskin. All right, God, fill me up now. Let's see what you got. And we go out through the week and we're pouring out. And I don't care if right before you walk through the door, you go, all right, leave that one there. Pick up the new one. And here we come. Fill us up, God. Because, man, them bones will start rattling. I mean, you guys have felt it. You know, when you want to start clapping or you want to stand up or you just want to, yeah, amen. You guys know what that rattling bone starts to feel like. And then when we all start to do it, you could feel it this morning as, you know, even things, you know, some things were going wrong, but all of a sudden it was like we all started to get together. We all standing and we were all, you know, right there as the vast army. And then what happened? All of a sudden it hit and it was just like, oh, there it was. There it was. And that's our lives. And that's only available because of what we're going to do this morning. Because of what Jesus did for us. That's the only way it happens. You see, with communion, he talks about the body being broken, the blood being shed. That's the only way we can have this life. If it wasn't for